Hello, everybody, and welcome to Wiregrass Haunts. This is your host, Stan Fikes, and I'm here with my awesome co-host, Miss Trista Yates. Are you there, Trista?
I am here.
Awesome. And y'all forgive my cell phone. Terry's texting me. So tonight's show is going to be awesome. It's kind of, I want to call it a redo, but it's just kind of fixing one of my screw-ups. So, but we had had a guest a few weeks ago, and actually there's three guests. There is Will and Becky Gydesen and Dave Clark from the Mystery Explained radio program. So we had them back on tonight, and it's going to be an awesome show. I've hated that we missed the first one, but I think this was probably going to be even better. But Trista, before we get into that, is there anything that you need to talk about, announce, or anything like that?
One second. Ashford, Alabama is doing a farmer's market every Saturday during the summer at the train depot. So it's good to buy local, so go there and do that.
Absolutely. Some good yellow-meated watermelons and... we bought one in Cottondale when we went to the beach Saturday, and I'm sorry, but it wasn't good. It wasn't sweet. It wasn't sweet at all. But it kind of changed my mind a little bit about yellow-meated watermelons. So, you know, that anyway, that's one of my demons I have to deal with. But
I don't think I've ever... I know that I have tried yellow meat, but I don't remember it, probably because I wasn't really a fan of it either. So I don't know. I like the red one.
Well, it's just something about eating a yellow watermelon. I mean,
right. It's like a mind control thing. Like you gotta brace yourself.
Yeah, watermelons are supposed to be red.
Right.
So, but that's okay. You know, we have some weird things here in the South. So, That'll work out. Yeah, it'll work out. I wanted to ask, how's your mom?
Mama is doing great. She's at home, and she said every so often she'll get really tired and she has to go and take a nap for a couple hours, which is understandable, but I'm just glad she's home and feeling better and taking care of herself like she's supposed to.
That's awesome. I was really, really concerned when you messaged me about her, and you know, that stuff's going around, and my dad's had heart issues, had triple bypass and stuff like that, but he's doing great now. So,
you
know, maybe your mom's on the upward swing there, and she'll be back to normal.
Yeah, she's even said they can't keep me down long.
That's
she's down determined to get back up and running, slowly but up and running.
That's cool. All right. Well, if you don't have anything else, I think it's time to bring in our guest, don't you?
Let's talk to him.
Let's talk to him. All right, guys. Are y'all there?
Yep, we're here.
Absolutely. All good.
Awesome. Will, are you there?
Sure am.
Awesome. Tell me something. Do you hear a big echo from me?
Yeah.
I did, but I don't know.
I think I hear it from me, too.
You hear it from you, too. Okay.
I hear it from me. I think it's coming from you through me.
Oh.
I hate when that happens.
That's weird, isn't it? Get out of me, Stan. Get out of me.
Okay, is that better? No?
It was fine for us all along, so I don't know.
Yeah. I still hear a little bit, but I don't think it's anything that's going to, like, wreck the show.
Okay, cool. All right. Well, guys, I finally got y'all back. Our last show was kind of a disaster. We'll blame Skype as usual.
Skype's going to kick us off the air.
But I honestly think that it was my fault, and I apologize. But, I mean, I can't be for sure, but we'll just blame Skype.
There you go.
That's cool. All right. So... have you guys been doing good? I mean, have y'all had some good investigations coming up?
We've had a lot going on, but, you know, as the paranormal goes, you don't always get activity. And that's part of the job. And unfortunately, it seems like that's what we've been running into more than anything else lately.
Yeah. Yeah, we had that same thing on our last investigation. Well, no, two investigations ago. But until we got home and searched through everything, I think we had one EVP. And I honestly think it was one of my guys talking. So,
yeah, Stan gets on to a stop whispering it's an EVP.
I've called them a ghost about 100 times, so, you know.
That actually happens a lot more than I think people think, that you mistake your team members for an EVP.
Yes, yes. And
I can be a ghost if I want to be.
Yes, Will, you can. You can be a ghost if you want to.
And one day you shall.
Right, right.
And he's going to haunt all of us when he does.
Oh, hell.
It's going to be some poltergeist crap going on, too.
There'd be shit flying everywhere.
It's going to splatter, that's for sure.
Well, that's cool. Yeah, we were talking about EVPs a while ago. I have one person on my team, and I'm not going to say their name, that just will not stop whispering. And we can hear that person every single investigation. And I say, well, I know that's not an EVP. And they go, how do you know? I said, I can tell you exactly who that is. And
right.
So,
it's not me, is it?
I'm not saying who it is. I'll
keep it away. Is it me?
Do you whisper?
Sometimes. I try not to, though. I'm getting better.
Okay. All right. Well, no, it's not you.
Okay, cool. I can deal with that.
There we go. But so I seen on Facebook where you guys were back at the slaughterhouse. Is that where y'all were investigating?
Yeah, it's a public event, actually, that we kind of like co-host with the slaughterhouse itself. And we're doing that on what better day but Friday the 13th.
And
that one's actually a really cool place. We've been there a few times, and Ghost Adventures was there, and we'll just leave it at that, and we'll say that our conclusion of this place is it's pranksters. The ghosts there like to play pranks, and what better place to do it at than a haunted attraction?
Right.
Sure.
So they're a lot of fun, and I'm looking forward to going back. We've had disembodied voices there before, and left recorders alone, and they've been messed with when they've been left alone, and just this place has had a lot of good evidence, so we're really glad to be going back.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
I just like the fun houses in there.
Yeah, you like to try to freak me out in them.
It's going to happen again.
Yeah, Will is the famous one for hiding behind things and jumping out and trying to scare people.
At investigations?
If I get bored, yeah.
That's hilarious.
I'll reach out and grab somebody while standing around a corner. When they're not looking.
That's
and watch
awesome.
Them pee all over themselves.
We're not naming names, but that person's on this interview tonight.
Dang!
Hey, now, that only happened once. That only happened once, and it was just a little bit.
And he's not the only one that's on this interview that I got.
Uh-oh.
Uh-oh. Will, you got yourself?
I did. It was tragic. I reached out and grabbed somebody. It wasn't who I thought it was.
Oh, my gosh.
Oh. Okay.
No, I'm just kidding. It's actually Becky.
Okay. Well, that's okay, I guess. I wasn't going to say it was Becky because she would beat me up probably if she could get to me.
Can you run fast?
I can roll.
That's still faster than her.
Hey!
Wow.
And all those slaps you hear are literally me hitting him, so.
Oh. I was wondering. That's awesome, though. I'm glad that you guys can manage to do that. Sometimes my team is a little too serious. Isn't that right, Trista?
Yes, sir, it is.
Yeah. but we are getting ready to come up with a bloopers video on YouTube.
See, I hate that I missed those. I really wish I could have seen all of that happen.
No, well, I'm glad they didn't get me on video walking into the side of the building. And it was pitch black, and I didn't have a flashlight, and I didn't have a camera or anything, just an EVP recorder. And as I turned around, I walked smack into the barn thing that they had out there, the investigation. Wow. I just stopped and looked. Did anybody see me?
Apparently so, huh?
Right.
Yeah. So, but we have some accidents and some crazy stuff go on. That's for sure. But, so I'm going to ask, if you don't mind, I'm going to ask each one of you a couple questions. And I'm going to start with Dave. Is that okay with you, Dave?
Nah, go for it.
Well, Dave, can you tell everybody why you're the way you are?
Well, that's going to take all night.
That might actually be best answered by other people. I don't know. No, that's just a weird question for me to have to answer because you mean just how I'm Dave?
Yes. How can you be Dave every day?
How can I be Dave every day? Wow. I don't even know how to answer that. I just wake up and I'm Dave. I mean, I don't know. I'm just being. I'm honestly just being me, and I don't know how to be any other way. I mean, it may not always be. I don't know. Sometimes it may be hard to take for some people, and sometimes it's fine with most people. I don't even know how to answer that. It's just that's a good ass question, Stan. It really is. I mean, I honestly don't even know what to tell you, like how I got to be me.
It took me all damn day to think that up.
Yeah, it sounds right. Like it. I can't even imagine having to answer that. I'm trying, but I just there's no words that can just answer that completely without going like way back. You know, like, well, I remember when I was a kid, you know, but I don't think that has anything to do with it, really. I just, sorry, I wish I had a better answer for you. I really don't.
That was cool. You did great.
I am who I am. I can't even, I don't know, man.
It was designed to make you fumbuzzled or whatever. You know.
Yeah, it definitely worked.
That's cool. Just do this. Just tell everybody how you got into the paranormal.
Well, being that I had some experiences prior to joining Tucson Ghost Society, that sparked my interest like completely 100%. And before that, I was on the fence about, is this real? Is this, you know, everyone's imagination? Is it just TV? But the more things that started happening, the more, you know, things I started to kind of feel like weren't quite right in multiple locations, different various places that we lived and stuff that I couldn't figure out. It just didn't make any sense. And then it wasn't just me, it was like family members as well. You know, everybody in the house had their own issues and even the dogs. So, once those things started happening, I really started to pay more attention. And then I started figuring out, that a lot of things were going on prior to that, that I wasn't really connecting with and putting the dots together. And it turns out they could have been related or it could have been leading up to bigger things that were happening, you know, at the time. But, you know, when you sit down and you start thinking about, well, I remember last week or 2 weeks ago when this happened, and then, you know, maybe they didn't get the response or maybe – we never really figured out what it was. So it's hard to say why those things were happening, but there were some pretty crazy things that started happening that just left me with my mouth open staring going, oh, my God, you know, that just happened. So that's pretty much how I got into it, and I had no choice at that point. It was just like, all this is going on. You have to go find out, you know, what you can. You have to at least try and make sense of it, which I never really did. And then I met Becky and Will. And then they said, hey, you want to come with us? And I said, cool. And then they said, cool. And then it was kind of like, that's how it snowballed from there.
Did they offer you candy?
Did they offer me what?
Did they offer you candy?
He was already like a kid in a candy store. No. We didn't need to give him any.
Yeah, why waste that if you don't have to?
Yeah, right. Right. That's pretty much true, though. I mean, it just fascinates me to no end. I mean, it's just, I can't wrap my brain around it enough. You know, I it just doesn't make any sense. And I'm trying to make sense of it, as we all are. And so we're probably all kind of in the same boat. Like, I'm trying to figure this out. We're trying to make sense, but it just doesn't. So we're just lost going, we need answers, but they're far and few between. So,
right.
You know, that's what, I guess that's what keeps me going. You know, it's like, I have to try and figure it out, but there's no figuring it out. So until that day comes, it's just going to be there going, hey, Dave, what about this? Hey, Dave, what about that?
Right.
So if you, if that day ever comes, are you going to be totally let down if it's not exactly, or does it live up to your expectations?
Well, I'll just be happy somebody got an answer. I mean, even if it's not me, but I don't know. I don't know if I'll be let down. I might try to dig a little deeper and say that can't possibly be it. You know what I mean? Because just because that's one answer or one possibility, it doesn't mean that's, you know, the only one. So there could be more stuff that, I mean, we're all digging, right? We're all digging for those answers. So if something comes up, how do I know that's really true? How do I know that's all there is? I'll probably still keep digging. I'll probably lose my mind in the process.
So it basically would just kind of fuel the fire. I mean, it would with me.
Right. Yeah. Because I mean, because that's the way it's worked so far for me in the past to the present. Every time something happens, I don't just go, well, that was this or this. You got to dig, you got to look into it, and you just got to keep going with it. Because if not, then there's your answer. Your answer is, I don't know what that is, and I don't care. You know what I mean? Right. That's basically what it comes down to. And there are people that are like that. They don't know what it is, and they don't care to know. Right. It's just not me.
I can relate to that, trust me. So you have obviously been on multiple investigations. Mm-hmm. Can you tell me, first off, which one was the most favorite? And secondly, did you ever get scared at any of them? Any type of frightening process or anything there?
Well, I would have to say, it's hard to say a favorite, but I can say that it was my favorite when it was a residential case that we did, and they're going to know which one I'm talking about. And it wasn't my favorite because it was super uncomfortable where we were. And as long as we were up there, it wasn't fun. But at the same time, there was some pretty cool, you know, evidence that came from that and some things that, you know, made me just kind of go, what, you know, again. So again, fueling that fire. But yeah, I would have to say it was a residential case that we did where, you know, there were people, there were voices that were right there, and we assumed it was an actual person. In fact, Becky even responded to them, and I just kind of laughed when I heard her response to what I thought was a human in the room with us, and it wasn't. And that, to me, just blew me away because it was so perfectly clear, and that particular voice had an accent. There were several, I think, in that investigation from what I remember that had an accent, but no one there had an accent, and no one was even in the room with us at the time. We just didn't realize it. Until later when we were, you know, doing the reveal and we were presenting things, and one of the guys, you know, that was, we assumed it was maybe him, was like, that wasn't me. And then we could tell right away that wasn't him. He didn't have an accent. He wasn't in the room. And there were several other, you know, really good voices through that. But that one just kind of took me back, a couple steps and went, wait a minute. We just assumed that was a human. That's how good that was, you know?
Right.
Like a living human. Sorry.
Yeah, I got you.
And as far as being scared, I've been startled, you know, and I peed that one time, but okay. I'm just kidding. No, but you know, when things happen and it's unexpected, yeah, it startles you. The equipment goes off or you hear something that you didn't expect to hear. But as far as like being scared enough to, you know, walk out or, you know, not continue or whatever, no, I don't think that would ever happen. Gotcha. I may be wrong, but I hope not. But I'll still come back. Even if I run out, I'm gonna come back. So
I keep waiting for that moment.
I know, right? That would be so cool. Yeah, but then everyone's gonna laugh. Look, he ran away. No, right. But I came back.
Okay. I just needed a minute.
Yeah. And I will say that the first time that I got touched, I did run, but it was the first time it happened. And it was just so unexpected because it wasn't during an investigation. It was just at my house, just laying on my bed. And, and it was middle of the day. And when it happened, the only thing I didn't even think twice. I just jumped up and pretty much hurtled through the bed and through the other side of the house. And I was just screaming, I got touched. Like, and I left my wife in there by herself. And she's like, what do you mean you got touched? You know,
good job, Dave.
But then I came back. You know what I mean? I came right back. I was like, you know, I just had to collect my thoughts and go, did that really happen? Even though I know what happened, it just didn't. It was just so in the moment when it was so unexpected that it just threw me off completely. And at that point, there were already things that were going on in the house that, you know, I wasn't really thinking about at the moment. But, you know, as soon as that happened, I was like, okay, well, that's one more thing that I need to find out what's, you know, one more thing that – one more little line on the chalkboard. You know what I mean?
Mm. Yeah, exactly. So what did your wife say about it? You running out on her.
She really didn't say much. She understood. She got it, but she didn't run. But then again, she didn't get touched. So, you know, and she knew at that point that there were things going on in the house because she had had her own experiences for a long time in the house, and we would share them back and forth. But at that particular time, she just looked at me like, oh my God, he just ran out of the room. Because we were right in the middle of a conversation. We were talking about something. We're watching a video on laying on the bed watching something on the computer, a little video about some exercise equipment or something, and totally unexpected when it happened. So I just jumped up and day was out. And, you know, she was just like, what? And I told her, and she just kind of went, oh, okay, well, I'm like, and then I came back and we talked about it and it was fine.
Ah, well, as long as you talked it through.
Oh, yeah.
So, well, that's cool. I mean, that's really interesting. Probably me being touched is kind of the same way, but I wasn't touched on the foot. And I wasn't even in an investigation either. I was at a friend's house and I was like way younger and, you know, it was really, really uncomfortable to get touched that way. So,
yeah. What way did you get touched, Dan?
well, actually it was like, it's like they grabbed me around my waistline I couldn't move. It wasn't any, you know, obscure place or anything, just around my waistline and I couldn't move, but I could feel both of the hands and it was like large hands and they just like grabbed my waist and I'm like, oh shit, you know,
right?
It was really uncomfortable. But I mean, that's not the reason I got into the paranormal, but, well, it may have played a part into it, but yeah, that's pretty cool I didn't run, couldn't run.
Yeah. Well, and, you know, I'm sorry, go ahead.
Oh, I was going to say, I think that's kind of a common thing for people who are interested in the paranormal is that they have had experiences on their own and they're like, what the crap is this?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think that's how it starts for a lot of people.
Right.
Yeah.
But yeah. I remember there was another thing that and I was scared. I can't say that I wasn't scared, but it was an investigation. It was at my house. So I don't know how well that fits into the question. But there was one time where we've all heard of the sleep paralysis issue that people have sometimes. Correct.
Sure.
And this was so not that. I mean, every time I try and tell someone, they just kind of like, oh, yeah, sleep paralysis, I know. But I'm like, wait, you didn't hear the story all the way. It was completely different in a similar way, which sounds really stupid, I know. But wow. I wasn't asleep. I was completely awake. I was laying in my bed. We were watching TV. I could hear the TV. I could see the TV. But all of a sudden, just the corners of like all my peripheral vision just started going dark. I just started getting dark. Didn't think too much about it. I was like, well, just my eyes, you know what I mean? Maybe I need to move them around, whatever. Then all of a sudden, I felt the sheets tighten down around me. So the sheets were tightened down around me. Yeah, and everything just went black. I couldn't see, but I could still hear. I could still hear the TV and what was being said. And that turned into not being able to move. I just felt like the pressure of the sheets, and I could literally feel the sheets. Like if you had a – the only way I can describe it, and it sounds dumb, but if you had like a leftover piece of meat or and you wanted to, you know, like shrink wrap it around there to keep it fresh or whatever, that's what it felt like. It felt like that's exactly what the sheets were doing. They were just pulled so tight around me I couldn't move. And then that led to just that tightness, that heavy feeling, and then I couldn't even say anything, and I couldn't come out of it. You know, it was so weird, but I could still hear. I didn't hear anything weird, but I couldn't move and I couldn't come out of it. And it took, I don't know how long it took. It seemed like forever before I could come out of it. And, of course, I freaked out when I came out of it. But I was completely still awake. You know what I mean? I never even lost consciousness. I wasn't asleep when it happened. I wasn't even tired. I was just watching TV. And it was the weirdest thing. And it's never happened again, but it was – that I was freaked out. I'll admit. That freaked me out.
Yeah.
Wow. Yeah, that is. That's kind of crazy.
Yeah, it was weird.
Yeah. Awesome. Well, I'm going to move on for a minute here, Dave. I want to hear why Will is the way he is.
Oh, can I answer? Can I?
Well, it all started one day. These guys came up in a white van. They have this jacket looking thing. I thought it looks like a white version of Michael Jackson's jacket. Until they put that thing on me and wrapped the sleeves all the way around the back of me and threw me in the padded van.
Wow.
Never been the same since.
Leave it to Will.
That was a good answer to that, Will. Awesome. All right. Will, how did you get started in all this stuff, brother?
Basically, it all just boils down to Becky. She just, really, it didn't even start with her asking, do you want to get into this or anything like that? Or how do you feel about it? And she said she wanted to go do a ghost tour down in Bisbee. She went and did that with a couple girlfriends. And about 2 weeks later, she calls me up and goes, how do you feel about buying a company?
Wow.
And my only response, and my only response was, will it make you happy? And she goes, yeah.
Oh, buy it. Oh, I got you. Yeah. Yeah. I did the same thing.
You out of trouble when you do that.
Right.
That's true. So, but Will, you haven't had any prior paranormal experiences or anything?
I did when I was a kid. We were having a Boy Scout jamboree that was dealing with the Order of the Arrow. And this was up in Gila Bend, up by Phoenix. And two of my buddies were out running around, and we actually saw an apparition of an Indian on horseback on top of the hill.
Mm. Wow. I honestly think I would like to see that. I mean, I've seen a lot of strange things, but I think I would like to see a Native American on a horseback.
Poplar Head Park right there on the corner of Maine and what is it, North Apple Tree, I think, is haunted.
I had heard that.
My granny, she had a picture from a long, long time ago, a newspaper article where somebody had taken a picture of it when they were getting ready to build it, and there was an apparition in the picture of a Native American on a horse.
Wow. So I would like to see an Indian on a horse. That's a spirit. I mean, that would just probably clinch everything about the paranormal for me. I might have to quit because I've just seen it all. But Will, did it? You being a kid or a young adult, did that scare you?
Actually, no. The only person that could ever scare me was my father. And my wife.
Hey now.
Wow.
Wow, that's news to me.
And well, my father can't scare me anymore, so that just leaves my wife.
Okay. All right. Well,
I have a question now. Why do I scare you?
Yeah. Why does she scare you, Will?
Because you're sitting right next to him.
Yeah.
Well, there's no creature on earth to fear like an irate woman.
That's true.
They can just be downright nasty.
So true.
My wife is listening, so I'm not even going to touch that.
Listen, if the guy, you can go ahead and get in a fist fight. You can win, lose, draw. It doesn't matter. You don't win when you get in a fight with a woman. It doesn't happen. And when she's mad, it's not just for a minute.
Well, I can definitely agree with you there. That shit goes on for months.
Yeah.
But anyway. So, do you enjoy the ghost tours or the investigations better, Will?
Actually, I like the investigations better. Mostly because I just like going in. Residentials are nice, but I'm more for like the old historical buildings.
Right.
Just because I like old things. And I like old buildings. I like caves. I like anything that is no longer relevant to society today are the things that I find more interesting. Because it's our history. It's our past. It's where everything started.
That's pretty awesome.
Do you guys ever go to, like, an abandoned place, with permission, of course, and investigate it? Or is it all, like, there are people there?
We did one, and it was just a side thing. It wasn't actually, like, we planned to go there and do an investigation, but we did one in Rhyolite, Nevada.
Yeah.
Where we knew it existed, and if you look on a map, it just says Ghost Town.
Oh, wow.
So we went down there, and it's literally, it used to be an old mining community, but they have a museum out there that was closed when we went out there, but also an artist has done a bunch of sculptures that look like ghosts. One's like the Last Supper, one's a ghost with a bicycle. I mean, it's basically a modernized version of art where the event's happening, but they're happening as a spirit.
Wow.
That's cool.
All the ruins are still there. Some of them they have fenced off as they're trying to restore it. But we got to go into an old mine shack where somebody apparently used to live at some time, and we did a makeshift investigation in there.
Did you guys get any evidence?
No.
Not really.
But it was still kind of cool.
Right, still fun.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
Yeah, but finding abandoned buildings that you can just easily access without having to go find permission and all that, it's kind of harder nowadays.
It is.
There's too many people have gone in and vandalized them while they're sitting there, so now it's like, lock them down.
Yeah, that kind of brings on the why people got to be so mean thing.
Right. You know, we just went to New Orleans, and we were going to go and see Marie Laveau's grave and tomb and all that.
Right.
And they did have a self-guided tour. But now they've closed all that off because people going in there and tearing up the graves and leaving trash everywhere and having parties and that type of thing. So, it's just crazy. And people just make it bad for everybody else that actually has good intentions that right. is after the history or, you know, that type of thing. So, So, Will, how often do you investigate? I mean, well, that's how often. how do you mix the investigations with your work? I mean, I don't know what your shifts and stuff are, but I mean, are you pretty clear at work to be able to do that?
Oh yeah, we schedule them all for like a Friday or Saturday night, so it doesn't conflict with my work. Sometimes I do get the occasional Saturday, and we do an investigation on a Friday. But for the most part, we get them scheduled to where it works around me. And then there are the exceptions I've made to where, you know, we get a spur of the moment. Hey, can you guys come out and do this? And I'll stay up and suck it up the next day and go to work.
Oh man, I've done that big time.
All right.
Yeah, I don't know what kind of work you do, but I'm a meat cutter, so I had to play with blades all day. So that's not a good place to go to sleep.
Yeah, fast and sharp blades.
Well, I'm an RV tech, so I get to play with drills, saws.
Oh, yeah. Well, you're right there on the same lines, that's for sure.
Climb up on roofs and...
Wow. No.
Oh, no. If I got up there, I'd probably lay down and go to sleep.
I'd lay down, but it would be for fear, not going to sleep.
Yeah. When I get off the creeper and go under them is when I start thinking about taking a nap.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Yeah, as long as you're snoring, don't give you away, you're good, right?
Right.
Yeah, I tend to find if you put one leg up and keep one out, then it kind of looks like you're still awake because it's hard to keep your leg upright when you're sleeping.
Right. So it just kind of moves and they think you're under there doing something. Awesome. I have to remember that.
Right.
So, well, obviously, Will, you enjoy the paranormal and the ghost tours, and I've been meaning to ask y'all, how long are the ghost tours? Do they last like a couple hours or whatever?
Yeah, we have the walking tour that lasts roughly 2 hours. We have the ghost experience that's 2 hours, and then we have the driving tour that's 3.
Wow. So y'all have a big area that y'all actually do the tours in, right?
Oh yeah. Now, if we can just get them filled up.
Wow.
That's cool. Yeah, absolutely. So I'm going to ask you basically the same thing I asked Dave about investigations. Have you ever been on one that you were scared? Or were you the one that was just always scaring everybody else?
I'm just the one that scares everybody else. Becky's over here clearing her throat.
I guess
she's having some flashbacks.
Well, Will, what's your most favorite piece of equipment to use?
He's thinking.
Wow.
He's thinking. I see the smoke.
Oh, hers, doesn't it?
Love you, babe.
Well, I like the Kinect, but it just, as long as you set it up in one spot and you leave it, it's fine. But if you're breaking it down and taking it to another spot, then it kind of gets tedious.
Right.
The FLIR would be cool if you actually got more activity with it. So I think basically Becky.
Your favorite piece of equipment?
Yeah.
Oh, my equipment.
You're a trigger object.
I'm a trigger object.
That is so Stan. That is such a Stan statement.
Wow.
Anyway.
Wow.
That was an awesome response, Will.
Dan actually sends us in to stir stuff up. Me and a couple of others, he's like, y'all go in there and stir some shit up. We'll meet you on the outside.
Yeah, that's crazy. Wow, that's awesome. That's awesome. All right, Trista, do you have any questions for Will?
Ask him if he's sleeping on the couch tonight.
Uh-oh.
No, I'm sleeping in the bed. She's just trying to act tough.
people. Ew.
If it weren't for Becky, you would actually be involved in the paranormal? Now that you know what it's about and you like it, like, do you think you would have ever started it?
No, I wouldn't have. I can be honest, I wouldn't have. I wouldn't have got into it if it wasn't for her.
Completely changed you all around, didn't she?
Well, I'm one of those people that believes that if your partner in life wants to do something, You want to do it with them.
Right, right.
Yeah. Because what's the point of having a partner in life if you're not going to share life with them?
Yep.
Absolutely. That's very true.
Aw, he gets to sleep in the bed.
Sleeping on the couch now.
You redeemed yourself, brother.
That's what I'm talking about.
Why are you crying?
Aw.
I feel the same way about my wife. I couldn't do anything without her. She keeps me straight. And, you know, everything that she experienced, I want to experience the same thing and vice versa. So, and that's one of the reasons why we work so closely on the investigations and even here on the show. You know, she may not be on the air all the time, but she's in the background working and, you know, on the investigations, you know, I can count on her to, if I'm tired or if I've got something that I've got to do, or if I just don't feel right, I can say, hey, can you go and help them investigate or whatever, or take them in or whatever. And, she's just there every time. And, it's awesome thing whenever you can experience life with your wife. That's a great thing.
Y'all are so sweet. Listen to y'all. Laying it on thick. Like, it's honey.
Peanut butter now.
I have a problem. I just bought a brand new couch for Teresa, and she won't let me sleep on it. So.
Well, I can guarantee you after tonight, it ain't happening either. I don't know. Don't push it.
Right. But that's pretty awesome. Miss Becky, can I ask you a couple of questions?
Oh, I guess.
Okay. I'm going to ask you a question. Why is Will the way he is?
Well, you know, I met him 9 years ago, and I decided, you know, I could mold him into something important.
And it didn't happen for us.
I tried and I worked so hard, and this is the end result.
Now she sleeps on the couch.
Damn it, man. Awesome.
And I'll tell you what, a king size bed is awesome to spread out on.
Right?
Yeah,
you can toss
yeah,
and turn and stretch and flip and fly. You can do whatever you want on it. There's so much room.
I would still sleep on the edge.
According to my 6-year-old, even when you have people in the bed with you, you can still do that.
Right, yeah.
It's like sleeping with your dogs. The dogs, they don't care. They got their paw up your nose.
Yeah. Yeah.
The kids are comfortable in any position.
Yeah.
At least it's your nose, Dave.
Right. Yeah, that's true. But then they start farting and they got to go.
I know that is right. Oh, my God. We just had recently, one of our dogs had puppies, and that is the nastiest smelling dogs.
Yep. Yep.
Yeah, that's crazy. Becky, what in the world got into you? You wanted to buy a ghost tour company. I mean, what made you do that?
You know, it's so funny because I have held down so many odd and end jobs, and you can ask Will, I didn't like any of them. I didn't last at any of them. I was awful at all of them.
When she says held down,
I had them for like a week.
I'm not sure that really applies.
In all honesty, I can do and I'm not, I've worked a lot of different jobs. You know, I've done office work, I've done retail, data entry, all kinds of different things, but they wouldn't keep my interest. They didn't have my interest, so I would get bored of them very fast. Mm-hmm. And when I bought the ghost company, I was actually in school, and I was actually looking to get into animal care, like to be a zoologist.
Oh, wow.
Because I knew the path I was on, I wasn't happy with these jobs. I needed something that would pique my interest.
Right.
And when all this paranormal stuff started, really getting into my life, I was like, you know what? This is something I'm truly interested in, and I know I could have fun with it. And that's just why I said to Will that, yes, this would make me happy. I knew this would be something that I could keep going with. And this is the longest, technically, that I've ever held a job. It's been 5 years since we bought the company. Oh, so wow. This is the longest I've stuck anything through. So.
Well, another thing, too, is that when dealing with paranormal, you can be whoever the crap you are and nobody really cares. Like, everybody is their own self. You right. don't have to get into a mold to be this certain person. You just be.
Yes. And I'm my own boss, so I can tell myself, you can take the day off. So it's great.
Wow. Wish I could do that. Right? I'm the boss, but I can't tell myself to take the day off.
I can give myself a raise. I can. The raise part is difficult. I need the tour company to bring in more money, but
All right.
There you go.
So basically, I can tell whether she gets a raise or not.
Hey!
Ooh. Ooh. Okay.
He's like getting the middle finger.
Oh, not the middle finger, no.
It's had a chance to heal.
It's no longer in the splint for me flipping them off so much.
Oh, my goodness. That's pretty awesome. So, were you in the... Did you have a paranormal team before you did the ghost tours, or was that kind of just coincided together, or...?
It went together. We bought the company, and everything after buying, well, even the company fell in my lap, but everything after buying this company literally fell in my lap. And I don't mean that to sound like snotty or anything like that, but it literally came to me.
It's meant to be.
Yeah. So when I got this company, I knew that people would be calling me saying, hey, I have a haunted location. Can you check this out? What do I do? I knew I would be getting those calls owning a ghost tour company. And I didn't feel that I was educated enough in the field to answer those questions. So I went seeking a good, grounded paranormal team, so to say, that I felt like I could trust to pass these people to.
Right.
And when I did that, they automatically just took me in and started training me. Not something I expected to do. And once they started doing that and I started doing these investigations and I was getting these calls, there's one building in particular that called to me and I would dream about every freaking night, literally, and I still want to buy it. And I looked at Will when I said, I still want to buy it. But this team that I was on was already kind of falling apart, not because they didn't want to do it anymore, but because they didn't have the time to do it anymore.
Right.
And when I asked them, can we please investigate this building? They're like, we don't have time. We can't do it. I had to. I just had to. So I asked them if they minded if I got a few people together and I went and investigated it on my own. And they told me, no, go right ahead. They had no problems with it. The, team founder even came that night to see our setup and he took some pictures and everything. He was all cool with it. And basically that's just how my team formed because theirs stopped doing cases. So we kind of picked up where they stopped.
Okay.
Yeah, so that kind of fell in my lap, and then the radio show, the writing, all that came to me. I didn't go looking for any of it. So
it sounds like it found a good home.
Right.
So I like to think so.
Well, it's not going anywhere anytime soon, so
that's good. That's good. You see, that shows dedication, and that's exactly what this field needs. It's people and teams that are dedicated to this field and things surrounding this field. Because, you know, you give people, I'm sure that you give people awareness and understanding when you're doing the ghost tours. They have a lot of questions because you guys are actually paranormal investigators. And you can kind of straighten up some of the myths and things that some people make up about this whole paranormal thing. And that's awesome.
Yeah, and, you know, the ghost tour, the walking tour, we really don't do anymore. We used to. But we can't manage to do that weekly because of the fact that we do investigations. But the ghost experience and the driving tour, it's always Will and I that do those. And especially at the ghost experience, we are constantly putting out there, you know, the education of it. You know, especially the fact that you want to be respectful to them. You know, we don't let anyone provoke while they're on our ghost experience. We make sure they understand that we can't make them perform. It's not like we can force them to come out. So we really push that educational part on the ghost experience, but at the same time, we like them to have fun, so.
Right. So when you go on a ghost experience, I'm sure that's when you guys teach them how to investigate, right? Is that right?
Yes.
Okay, so how many people do you take at the time?
We limit it to about 18 people per night when we do them, and we do them like every other Monday night. Most of the time we don't get that packed except for during the month of October.
Right.
And when that does happen, we tend to split the groups in two so it doesn't overcrowd.
Wow, 18 people though.
We try to keep things simple and limited because we don't want to overdo it.
You know, we actually... Web Paranormal actually done a investigation at Pauley Jail where we had tag-alongs. In fact, that's how Trista came to be a part of our team.
And we
ultimately, I think we had altogether about 10 people besides the team. And it drove me mad. I mean, you know,
a lot of people there.
Like, oh my God, you know.
And then you have tag-alongs, but then you had, like, their plus one, plus the other team. It was one or two other teams that were there, too. So, yeah.
That's a nightmare.
I managed to keep it all together with the help of my wife and some of the other team. But, you know, I had 18 people like that every – I don't know. That,
right.
I'd probably yank my hair out or something, what's left of it. But so that goes on every other Monday. Sorry for the tongue tie.
Yeah, it goes on every other Monday. We actually have one set up for July 2nd.
That's awesome. So
we're going to have our new team members go to that and kind of learn what the company does too, because as the team knows, the company is basically the founding part of the team. So,
right. Well, I was going to ask you, did any other people in your team help out with your tours?
Yeah, they do when it comes to our special events, especially when it comes to the ghost experience, they'll come and do it for free. And, you know, I tell people that they're on the team, so if they have questions, I can ask them, too. But other than that, they don't really work, so to say, on those nights. But when it comes to the special investigations that we do, like Slaughterhouse, a lot of times I'll ask for volunteers, and they'll come, and they help guard the areas, so to say, and make sure that everyone's behaving and no one's provoking and doing things that they shouldn't be doing. So, yeah, the team's really good about doing that. We also do a lot of guest speaking, so they'll volunteer to come with me with the guest speaking and things like that. So,
cool.
We have a pretty bunch right now.
So when you do the ghost experience, and of course you let them use your equipment and that type of thing, have y'all gotten any evidence or EVPs or anything like that when y'all were doing that?
Yes, we actually have. What's really funny is there was one night that I was giving them a tour around the building because we let them know where they can go, where they can't. And when I gave them the tour, it was quiet. And then I, you know, explain everything and I let them do their thing and we just kind of keep an eye on them, but we don't crowd over them so they can have their own experience. And I went towards the back of the building and I like to talk to these spirits because we do this at La Cucina. And they're very familiar with me because I've been there for the past, I don't know, 4 years, maybe more, 4.5 years we've been doing this. And so I was asking them, I'm like, you know, please interact with us tonight. We'd really appreciate it. You know, it would really give these, you know, people a thrill. And right as I'm saying this, I'm hearing someone singing. And I'm like, okay. And then it gets louder. And the guests on the tour are hearing this too. And we're all like thinking there's a car outside with, you know, their music blaring. And so I asked, well, can you go check that out? And he goes outside and there's no one around. And in the meantime, the music keeps getting louder and louder. So Will gets back in the building and we're like, that's coming from the building.
Oh, wow.
So we go in the areas that you're not supposed to. So I'm texting the owner saying, if alarms are going off, it's because we're going into this area because there's music playing. Mm-hmm. So we go back to this one shop that's completely closed off. Nobody was back there because we were the only ones in the complex. And we find a radio hidden, like, behind a partitioner type thing that was turned on and playing.
Wow.
It was not turned on when we got there. We even confirmed with the owner. We're like, did you have this radio on today? She goes, I was the only one at the complex, and I did not touch the radio.
Oh, wow.
So that was really cool to have that. And then we turned off the radio, and we went back to the guest, and we were explaining, you know, what we had found. And right after we explained it, we heard a whistle. Everybody heard the whistle.
Wow.
So that was really cool that night. And then we've had, like, newscasts come out there, and they've caught things turn on when we've been filming for the news. They've caught flashlights turning on and things like that. So we've had, you know, activity out there, and for the most part, it's really good. But we've noticed that sometimes the weather plays parts in it, and
right.
When it's colder, they don't seem to interact as much, so I don't know if the cold affects them. When it's overly hot, they don't interact as much, too. So we really wonder if the weather affects them, too.
Hmm. Well, that's, yeah, I would think so. That's interesting. Trista, do you have any questions?
I do not. I do know it's break time.
Yeah, I was going to say, it's 8 o'clock. So, guys, we take about a 10-minute break, mainly because some of us can't hold our water. But so, y'all hang tight, and we're going to play a little bit of music and a couple of advertisements and stuff like that. The old thing, we got to pay the bills. Okay. So, anyway, all right. Well, guys, hang on. Everybody, thank you for listening to Wiregrass Haunts. We're at our break. And if y'all will give us about 10 minutes, we'll be back. Y'all enjoy a little bit of music. Thanks. Voices Carry Radio Network.
Are you looking for web design, press releases, blog posts, product descriptions, academic writing
to cheat in class,
social media marketing, and even logo design? Don't worry, there's a lot more, but I'm not going to list them right here. You need to visit Arden Marketing Enterprises at arden-ent.com. That's arden-ent.com. Or if you would like to speak personally to the owner of Arden Marketing Enterprises, call Teresa Fikes at 334-648-1214. Again, Teresa Fikes at 334-648-1214. Get on it.
Do you want to have family portraits made but can't afford the costly photographers out there? Do you want to help someone local grow their business with low-priced, budget-friendly photo shoots? Would you rather have someone who is understanding of what you need in a photo of your family? Want someone who will listen when you have ideas during your photo shoot? Call Trista Yates Photography. We do newborn, senior, family, professional headshots, as well as birthday shoots to celebrate every year of your child's life. Need a holiday photo? One for your Christmas card? Look up Trista Yates Photography on Facebook and give her page a look. Great photos, better pricing. You won't be disappointed. Call Trista Yates Photography at 334-718-8840. Again, 334-718-8840.
Spinning round and round, round and round and round.
Are you struggling with credit issues? Bad credit keeping you from pursuing all your dreams? Coleman Credit Repair is here and will get you back on top. It does not matter whether you have had any negative marks on your credit report, repossessions, bankruptcies, foreclosures, tax liens, medical bills, student loans. All of these things are negative to your credit report. However, Coleman Credit Recovery can help you and your credit recover in a way that will make you feel like you are back on top of it all. Give Shawana Coleman a call today and find out for yourself how Coleman Credit Recovery can get you back on top of your game. Call today at 334-405-4351. Again, the number is 334-405-4351. The only regret you might have is not calling Coleman Credit Recovery sooner.
Hello, everybody, and welcome back to Wiregrass Haunts. We were just having an interesting conversation, so you'll forgive my laughing. But
y'all have no idea.
So, for everybody that has just joined us, we have a great show going on. We have Will and Becky Gydesen and Dave Clark from the Mysteries Explained radio show. We've had a great show, the first part. Guys gave us a lot of information about themselves, and Dave couldn't tell me why Dave was the way Dave is.
Oh, brother, I wish I could have. I wish I had that magic answer, man. I even went downstairs and tried to find it, but I couldn't find it, so I came back up.
You're probably going to have to ask his sister.
See, okay. That all depends on what sister you ask.
I have that situation. I feel you.
Yep.
That's pretty cool. But Will answered the question pretty good. Then, of course, I asked Becky to tell me why Will was the way he was, and she really answered it good. So we're here. I wanted to let everybody know, if y'all have any questions for these guys, y'all please ask, because I'm pretty sure you'll get some entertaining answers. We were talking about the guided tours that you guys have. Dave, do you ever help out with the tours?
Yeah, I try not to. Anytime I can be there and be available to help out, I'm there. I mean, anytime I can make it, I make it, whether it be a tour or experience or whatever. So
that's awesome.
Yeah, Dave's down for the paranormal regardless of what aspect it is.
All right.
I think he likes playing with the ghosts more than he does people.
Right.
That's pretty true. That's pretty true. Wait a minute.
We have a team member that likes to do that same thing. she was at our Pauley Jail investigation, and she's one of our founding members. And she went into the conjugal cell.
And,
and she laid down, and y'all, I'm not going to repeat what I heard on.
I think we can take it from there.
Right.
It was a mental room. But
I think I saw something similar on TV once.
Yeah.
My wife just answered it in the chat room. But that was pretty weird. So that's getting down with the spooks and the ghosts. And, I'm not into that part. But
that was so much fun.
Yeah, that was pretty, pretty awesome. So, you guys, do y'all have just one place that you run the tours or do the ghost experiences, or is it multiple buildings or areas?
Well, the ghost experience is it's kind of like a little shopping center. Because there's multiple stores there. But we usually keep it in the art gallery and the courtyard. That's where we have the access to. One of the other stores in there has offered to let us investigate in there if they're in there at the time. So when they're there, they'll open up the shop and let the guests go in there and investigate. The walking tour pretty much stays the same unless for some reason somebody comes up and says, hey, I got this great story for this location and it's mine. So you're more than welcome to talk about it, come in or whatnot. And then the driving tour, that's one that it's one of our more recent tours. It's still pretty new. So what we have on it now is basically what Becky's hard work and time has come up with. And we're always more than willing to add other businesses onto the tour. All they have to do is let us know what the deal is with their business, and Becky will get the rest of it taken care of.
So these buildings are occupied with businesses?
Yes.
Most of them are, yes.
Yeah.
Huh. That's awesome. I know when we were in New Orleans, there was people coming from all around to go to some of these tours. I mean, do y'all have that same thing? I mean, people coming from way away or, you know, other states?
Most of our guests are usually out-of-towners. We do get the locals, but most of them, yeah, they're from out of state and another city. We've had people from Canada.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, that's pretty awesome. I mean, of course, I mean, y'all are a good ways away from Canada. I mean,
yeah, right?
Definitely.
Yeah, y'all are closer to us than they are Canada. So. Yeah, that's pretty awesome.
We also work with a lot of local groups a lot. We've done a lot of special tours, and we'll revamp our tours, you know, for certain groups. Because, like, we'll do the Girl Scouts every year. They want to take a tour, but they don't want to do the full two-hour tour. So we cut it down to an hour for them, and we give them special prices. We've worked with the Wounded Warriors. We've worked with book clubs. We've worked with a lot of different groups, and if they don't want to do a full 2 hours or they don't want a night tour, we work with them and, you know, try to accommodate what they need.
That's awesome.
Go ahead.
I was just saying we have fun with it, so.
Okay. Do you guys ever do any type of fundraisers with it or anything?
We've done one so far.
It was for Tucson's Canines. Causes
for Canines.
Yeah,
is what we did. We did a picnic, and we had a silent auction raffle to raise money for them. We're still looking into doing other events to try and raise money for local charities. And we found out that it's not as easy as it sounds. There's a lot of red tape in doing it.
Yeah,
it's something we're not even making any money off of when we do it. It's just all volunteer to help out with the community. But apparently they want you to have all kinds of insurance. And,
which we do have now. So yes, yay.
We do have now.
Right.
That was the first one we ever did. And yeah, it's not something we found that you can just throw together at the last minute and do. It actually takes months of planning and red tape cutting to pull it off.
So is that something that you would think you'd do in the future, or is that?
We plan on doing it. Right now we're at a kind of a hold up because of the fact that I'm on a time limit to write a book. Right. And so we're focusing on the investigations for this book and the research for this book and me sitting down and actually writing this book. So that's where all of our focus is right now. As soon as this book is finished, we're planning on doing some more charity work.
That's cool. Your book that you're writing, when do you expect to have that out? Because I'd love to read it.
Right. It is actually due in October of 2019. It's through Arcadia Publishing and the History Press, so I'm under contract. I actually have to have the script or whatever you want to call it, the manuscript into them by January. So considering, and don't tell anyone, that I haven't written one word for this.
Okay, I won't tell them so.
What's it going to be about? Like, what's the gist of it?
It's haunted Tucson.
Okay, cool.
Yeah, they actually approached me and they asked if I wanted to write Haunted Tucson for them. They've been going to, you know, trying to get each different cities to, you know, come up with these books and stuff. And they approached me to write the one for Tucson. And yeah. I was thrilled and I said, you know, yes. And we just found out in, I think it was January, that the contract went through and we signed all the contracts. And since then, we've been getting the release form signed, doing the interviews, doing the investigations. So it's been a lot of work off screen, so to say.
Right.
And I keep telling these locations that I would prefer to investigate them. I can go off their stories and I will include their stories, but I also like to have that personal touch when I'm writing.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, it's better to have that. That's for sure. I agree. Yeah.
So we've been doing a lot of investigations for this book, and that's where we've been concentrating. And we have a case coming up Friday that I'm interviewing someone that night and we're investigating that night. So it's a combination of both for this book.
Okay. Cool.
So when you approach people to get these investigations and stuff, do you let them in on that it's going to be in a book, or do you have to get their permission, or is...
Yes, I have to let them know. In fact, that has actually opened doors for us, being that they're going to be in a book.
Right.
Some people are like, ooh, free advertising.
Hell yeah, I'm going to be in a book, y'all.
I'm going to be in a book.
So that actually opened some doors. Some others, they were like, nope, not interested. We don't want it out that we're haunted. One in particular was like, we just want our guests to enjoy their stay here. We don't want that out. So
right.
To each their own. We found that some places, you know, just are a little bit more difficult to deal with than others. So
sure.
Well, little do they know, they're obligated to buy 500 copies of the book.
Damn.
We want to be on the top seller list, people, okay?
Absolutely.
If you're going to go, go big.
Heck yeah. Yeah, that's awesome. So, Dave, are you going to be in the book?
God, I hope not. I would hate to read that chapter.
Well, that's chapter one.
Dave is going to be in there like glitter. He's going to be everywhere.
That's the prelogue, the chapter.
Well, good luck selling that.
Ending.
Yeah, I said top seller people, top seller. No.
They're going to terminate her contract right away.
Yeah, I know, huh? No, actually, Dave is taking part in this book. Dave is actually doing all the photographs for the book.
Oh, cool.
Whether he likes it or not, his name's going to be in the book.
Yes.
Damn it, man. Awesome. Yeah. So you're going to put a chapter in here that says, this is how Dave really is Dave.
this is how Dave became Dave. And there goes the decline of Western civilization right there.
And we've already interviewed both his sisters. And
we know the answers.
We got it all.
We got all the dirt.
So Dave, you can do a retro shot of yourself through a mirror.
Oh, he's into another mirror. To us already.
Yeah. See, it's already going downhill.
Yeah, I heard the pennies fall out of the bag as we speak.
Right?
Yeah.
I'm going to make my little bindle, and I'm going to go on about my way.
Yeah, you know, I do plan a second book. We're kind of keeping that one under wraps right now, so, you know, Will just spoiled it, but...
Oh, man.
All haunted portals.
So, Will, are you co-writing this book, or
no, is it all you? Becky.
All Becky.
Yep.
Awesome. Becky, don't you do some sort of column or something for a local paper?
Yes, I do. It's actually called TucsonHappenings.com, and I write a monthly article called Arizona Paranormal. And I've been doing that for... gosh, over almost 2 years now, I think.
Oh, wow.
Over 2 years now. Yeah. Again, that was something that they just approached me and they said, how would you like to write a monthly article? And I'm like, sure. I have problems saying no, apparently.
Obviously.
Yes.
All right, Will.
Yes, she has a huge problem with saying no.
Gotcha. So, are you guys pretty much the only team in your area, or is there a bunch of teams?
No, I wish I could say we are, but we're not.
There's probably about five others that we know of.
Oh, wow.
But as far as their recognition or being known, they're not really... I don't think they're really recognized, and nobody really knows about them. So they're kind of more like, I wouldn't call them paranormal teams, but more like followers.
Right.
Because they're not really looking to debunk anything or find anything. They're just looking for the thrill of it.
Oh, yeah. They're in for the wrong thing.
All right.
Yeah, exactly. Anybody in the chat room, y'all ask some questions, because now's the time. Ask anything you want today.
Well, we have a couple people on our paranormal team in the chat room, and I'm surprised they haven't asked anything weird. Or
they're probably afraid.
They're on their best behavior, apparently.
they want to be in the book.
Right? Now,
they're probably scared of the responses they're going to get.
Well, hey, yeah. Yeah, I bet they asked Dave why he's Dave.
So. No, you know.
Sorry, that question's already been asked. Can't ask it again, man. That's we've moved on.
Dan has got copyright on that question.
Yeah, exactly. So I know the weather is totally different there, where you guys are compared to where we are. We're sloppy wet most of the time and hot. How does the weather affect your tours and your investigations and that type of thing?
You know, it's funny because you would think during the summer would it be completely dead. And we do die down, and I know, good choice of words there, huh? But we get this, like, spurt, it seems, in the month of July, which is one of our hottest months. And I don't know if the heat just, like, gets to people and they're like, let's go out in the heat even more. I don't know. But we do notice a decline in the warmer months. In the winter, people out here, they don't mind being out in it because it's not really that cold. Right. Especially for visitors. I mean, locals, we get cold. But, you know, for visitors, they're like here in shorts and wearing like jackets and scarves.
Let's put it this way. It's almost 7 o'clock here and it's 95.
Yeah. So it's still warm here. Very warm. And then during the winters, our, you know, lows are usually, 40s or 50s?
That's at night.
Yeah. So we don't get too cold here during the winter. We'll get maybe one week that it's, like, really cold.
Right. Huh. I wish it was, like, 40s at night here. Sorry. Yeah, this place gets pretty musky and hot during the summer, and even at night we're in the 70s and 80s, but wintertime it gets kind of cool here some. Not exactly where I'm from, but the cold here, but we seem to investigate better when it's cold.
So I mean
do y'all investigate better when it's a certain weather condition?
I think we're pretty much all around the same. I think summer's the worst because it's so friggin' hot here.
Yeah.
I think given that the weather doesn't change too much here, it pretty much doesn't – it's not even a thought. You know what I mean? Unless it's raining or something maybe, but we don't think too much about it. It's like, yeah, it's going to be the same, you know, until it gets to be – what we call chili, and then you might need a little jacket or something. But other than that, it's pretty much the same year round.
Yeah, we have two seasons, summer and summer.
Yeah, pretty much.
Right.
Pretty much. We're approaching the rains. They're just teasing us right now. We're still about a week or two away before they really kick in, but then we'll get some humidity and then it'll be 110 or whatever, and it'll be a little bit worse, but we're all used to it, so it's no big deal.
Sure. Teresa is in the chat room. She said, we even go out in thunderstorms. We do. I mean, call us crazy, but I think that kind of intensifies the paranormal level, you know, that we're looking for.
Yeah.
You guys do that too?
We have pretty much the same motto as the post office: rain, hail, sleet, snow, it don't matter. It gets delivered on time.
Wow. Awesome.
Yeah, it doesn't snow or sleet here.
We get hail.
It's very rare. Just like the snow is very, very rare.
The size of that hail we got last year? Holy crap.
Wow. Well, we get snow occasionally here. You know, we may have a little bit of accumulation, like 2 or 3 flakes or something, you know. And of course, if there's 2 or 3 flakes, then all the schools close and the roads close and stuff like that.
Here it's the floods. When we get rain, we get flooded and things get closed down because of the flood.
Well, no, that's right. Not true.
Well, roads do.
But believe it or not, we do on occasion get snow in the city.
Yeah, and if we get like not even an inch, schools close.
Yeah.
Right. Well, that's the same way here. You know, if they talk about
Ohio, it would be like 3 feet of snow, and they're still debating on if they want to close schools or not.
Right. Yeah, back in North Carolina, it was the same way. You know, we had 20 inches on the ground, and you better not be late for class.
Here, a lot of people have no clue how to drive when it snows.
No, that's the same. Yeah, that's the same here.
It's like they lose concept.
We don't need any kind of weather. They just can't drive.
Oh yeah, it's like they lose all concept of how to drive, and they think, there's snow. I better slow down to like 2 miles an hour, and then you got the idiots that go, oh, this isn't nothing, and then they're sliding off the roads.
Right.
Well, it's all the ice, brother. It's the black ice. That's a plague around here, you know, bridge tops and stuff like that. Hence the signs that says bridges ice before the roads. That's true around here for sure.
Oh, we have those here.
You were talking about people driving. People around here don't know how to drive, whether it's sleet, snow, ice, whatever. You know, they just don't know how to drive. And, I think I'm going to put a stand outside the road and advertise blinker fluid.
Right.
Well, I've always said that everybody in Arizona gets their driver's license out of a Cracker Jack box.
How do you really use a median?
Right. Yeah, exactly.
To properly know who has the right of way.
Right.
How to park in just one parking spot.
Absolutely. Or how to drive in a straight line.
Or how to get the hell out of my way.
Well, here there's a lot of people pulling boats. So when they park in a parking spot, it takes up like 4 and half the road.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I go park out somewhere, and my wife says, can we park a little closer? We don't have to walk. I said, no. You know, we just park away from people.
Yeah.
I use the whole exercise thing. Just think about it. You get your exercise between here and Walmart.
Right.
That's pretty cool. So y'all have an investigation coming up Friday.
Yes.
That's a business or a residence or?
It's a business.
Oh, that's awesome. And
this is one that's going to be getting included in the book.
Now, are these people, this business known for activity, or
it is.
I don't think a lot of people know, but some people do know. And the lovely show Ghost Adventures tried to get in there too, apparently.
Yeah.
Wow.
It was so funny because I was talking to security when I was there, you know, finding out if they wanted to be in this book or not. Mm-hmm. And I'm talking to the one security guard and he goes, yeah, that one show, I can't think of the name, but the guy always goes out screaming and yelling. And I'm like, oh, Ghost Adventures. They're like, yeah, that one.
Wow.
I'm like, okay. They're like, yeah, he tried to get in here.
So they couldn't, but you guys did?
Apparently.
That awesome. Is awesome.
Yes, that is awesome. Yeah. One for you guys, none for Zach. Yeah, that's cool. I like that. Have you guys visited this business, or y'all have never investigated there before, right?
We've never investigated before. We've been there, but we've never investigated.
So when you guys go in to maybe secure an investigation, do you have people that go in with you, kind of like my team? I have certain people that goes to certain places because, you know, they're a high sensitive or, you know, that type of thing. So do you have guys that do that?
We basically, when we go in, it's the team leads usually that will go in with us. And usually we'll be interviewing, trying to get the feel. I'm probably the most sensitive out of all the others, I would say. Mm. And there's sometimes that, and not lately though. Lately, we haven't had much luck on a lot of things. But I know when we first started, the activity was always centered around me, it seems, which is why I think Will said earlier that he uses me as the trigger object.
Right.
we try to just get the feel of things. We, you know, do the interviews, especially when it comes to residential cases, though. We'll look around us to see what the residents have, so to say.
Right.
If you're getting my drift, you know, if there's alcohol and, you know, prescriptions and stuff like that. But when it comes to businesses, we just basically do the interview. We kind of get the feel of things and kind of go from there, I guess.
Well, we do similar things to that as well, but I have like several on my team that are really, really high sensitives, and I kind of send them in certain places, you know, and let them kind of tell me, hey, you know, I don't have a psychic or a sensitive bone in my body. I just can investigate really good. I mean, that, you know, I can dig up shit. But that's been a question of mine for a long time to other groups. You know, do you kind of let your sensitives or? But I don't know if every group has sensitives. I mean, I really don't know. I've just always had that on my group.
Right. So. In all reality, Will and I decided a long time ago that we want this group to be skeptics. So even though I'm sensitive, it may lead us to a certain area, but I don't let it influence me. And we've been very strict on, you know, if psychics or sensitives want to join the team, that they have to learn not to go off their emotions, but to go off the evidence.
Right.
Because both Will and I have had experiences that, you know, we were like, okay, we thought this happened, but we have nothing to back it up. So we'll tell the client, we had this personal experience, but unfortunately we can't back it up. Right. And we're very picky on what we present because we don't want to go screaming ghost to everything.
Right.
Right.
And because I feel that teams that do that, they kind of come off as non-believable after so long, because everyone's like, you called ghost to that, you called ghost to that. So we really try to be the skeptics, and we really try to debunk, and we really try not to use that psychic intuition. We're not saying completely ignore it, but we're saying we want the evidence to back it.
Yeah.
I think we have a combination of both on our team. Like, we have the sensitive, what are you doing right now? We have people that are like, crap, this is going off.
Well, when you have like a sensitive or medium type situation, and then you've got something like an EVP recorder or a spirit box or something that can validate, you know, it really helps. But right. even in that case, you know, not everything is paranormal by any means. And we've gone to places that we, you know, we thought, hey, you know, we got this. And when we got to looking at it, everything was completely explainable. Right. And, yeah, so it's not something that you holler ghost on every turn.
Right. Well, I'm going to call out one of the people in the chat room right now. Her name is Mayela. We call her May. Her and I went and we did this investigation that was like a public thing where I was a guest speaker. And there is so-called psychics on this. Mm-hmm. And I swear to you, it's like, you'd hear one say, oh, there's this little girl here. And then you'd hear another one say something completely different. And I'm sitting here and all they're doing is talking and saying what they're seeing. And I'm sitting here and I'm going, and May's doing the same thing, going, prove it. Prove it. Because not that I don't believe in psychics, but anyone can say they're psychic.
Right.
In all reality, anyone can say, I'm psychic. I could say I'm psychic. And then what they do is they play off of your emotions. They play off of, you know, random facts and all this stuff. So I want the proof.
Right.
And I've always been that way. I love this field. I believe in this field. But I am one of the biggest skeptics in this field, too.
In a lot of ways, that's the best way to be, so that you actually have the proof. Like, it's not just the way somebody feels, you know. Right.
Well, that, and we also live in a society that where, show me.
Right.
You know, it used to be somebody could walk up to you and say, yeah, this happened to me, and this is what's going on. And now everybody's like, yeah, that's great. Show me.
We were at the flea market one day, and we have this one lady in Dothan that claims to be psychic, and she's like all the time ripping people off. So she was at the flea market handing out flyers, like, come see me, I'll give you a reading, da 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 da. And then we were walking. And then they were like, no, go talk to her. So then she comes over. She's like, I can see a lot of good things for you. I'm like, if you were psychic, you could tell that I don't want you beat up in my face right now. You know, I'm telling you, this is a vibe that you should be catching right now. If you were psychic, you should know this.
Right. Exactly. You know, I don't completely believe in them. I'm not saying that people don't have that ability, but it's just too easy to say I'm that way.
Right. Sure. Right.
Oh, yeah. And of course, whenever I'm setting up these investigations and how they're going to play out and stuff, I don't use that as a option for me to, oh, we need to go to this area because this is, they said this and this and this. I don't. I do listen to them sometimes if we have a validation on something. Hey, I picked up on this, and then, you know, we have something that points towards that. But ultimately, in the end, when we're going over evidence and things like that, we kind of do like you guys, multiple people have to agree that's what that said or that's what that done. Otherwise, we just throw it out, basically. So, you know, that... It's a useful thing, but you're right. You know, anybody can say, well, I'm this way or I'm this way, but it's pretty easy to weed those people out, too.
Right. Yeah, I don't know. I just feel that in this field, it's so easy for people to say, I'm psychic, I'm sensitive, I'm a medium, I'm an investigator even. You know, it's just way too easy. There's no classifications, there are no requirements. And because of that, there are people in this field for the wrong reasons, and it's making this field go downhill because of the fact that people are getting ripped off by these people that really aren't that way.
Very true. Very true. And a lot of people that's in this field today are, they're looking to be the next Ghost Adventures or the next Ghost Asylum and things like that. That is not why.
On Ghost Hunters. I loved that show. I, as everyone knows, I love Grant Wilson. You know, I love his videos that he does on YouTube now, you know, because he really encourages the really good foundations of this field that I really do believe everyone needs to follow.
Sure. And when
I miss people like him being more active in the field. More mainstream.
That's true. And, you know, when TV shows stop and get canceled and that type of thing, and those investigators continue on working, then I can say, yes, that was a good show. And, of course, Taps was great. You know, Ghost Hunters, that was a great show. That was one of the first ones that really opened up this field. Other than Paranormal State.
Yeah.
But these same investigators, whenever they stop the TV show, but they continue investigating. And I think Grant and Jason and those guys do.
Yeah.
And, you know, I think that's awesome. They actually got into it for the right reason and are continuing. They just had that lucky break and, you know, they got the information out there and got a little, you know, fame, if you will. But when Teresa and I started this, we weren't looking for any fame or anything. There's no way we would do that.
Right.
You know, because I don't know how much those people make or anything like that, but that's not, you know, I couldn't really go and do that and let people pay me for any part of it.
Right.
It just wouldn't be right. But you know, but having a ghost tour, I think that's an awesome thing, though. That would be something that I could probably get at sink my nails into. I'm pretty sure it's a lot of work. But
it's a lot of work to get together the stories, and you know. When I first got the tour, you know, it was a lot of revamping, figure out, you know, how the walking's going to go to where we're not zigzagging back and forth. And it worked out, though. I'm happy with, you know, a lot of the stories. I'm actually going to, after I finish my book, I'm probably going to revamp the tour, add some different stories because of the fact that I have so many new stories that aren't in the script because of the fact that I've been doing this for so long.
Right.
And I need to concentrate on that book first, though. But, you know, new tours, you know, we're always looking to do those and new locations and all new stories. After the book is finished, I'm going to be focusing on revamping some of the things and making it a little new so people that have done the tours before, if they retake it, they won't recognize all the stories.
I was going to ask you if you have a lot of repeat customers that come back every year to do the tour.
We do have some that they enjoyed the tour, and then when their cousins or whatever come out to visit, they're like, oh, we got to do this tour, and they'll come back and do the tour. So that's really cool. And then we have repeat customers that'll do each tour. We actually had one a couple months ago that did the driving tour, and she goes, I've done your ghost experience. I've done your, you know, walking tour. I had to do the driving tour. So, you know, we love hearing that. We love that. She was actually really cool saying, hey, if you need help with this and that, you know, give me a call. And, you know, it was just really cool. So we do sometimes get that, and I really appreciate it because Will and I, well, you know, we're just here. We're, you know, local people. We're not this huge corporation. We don't live in a mansion, you know.
Right.
We got bills and four kids to take care of, you know. So.
Yeah.
I can relate to that.
You know, we're not getting rich, you know. So go take the tour, and when the book comes out, buy the book.
There you go. There you go. I was going to say, I mean, it's 10 till. We still got a little bit, but give your book a plug and your group and your tours and everything. Let everybody know where and how and that type of thing.
Well, it's pretty cool because we're pretty easy to find, especially myself. I'm like on all social media. I'm on Instagram. Mysteries Explained is on Twitter under Mysteries Radio. We're on Facebook under Mysteries Explained, Tucson Ghost Company, and Tucson Ghost Society. My Facebook page is always public. Everyone can find me. And our website is TucsonGhostTour.com. All the information is listed on our website. And our team, of course, Tucson Ghost Society, investigates for free. We never charge. The tours is what keeps us going, basically, and keeps equipment updated, besides Will being our bank of Will.
And bank of Will.
I need to start charging interest.
Will, do you have an online application, brother?
Only if you're married to me.
Oh, damn it. That's just weird.
Well, the good news is they're Mormon. It's okay.
Oh, okay.
But yeah, damn, I mean, Dave. Tucson Ghost Society honestly would not exist if it wasn't for the company and for Will. You know, I'm the one that wanted the team. I'm the one that formed it, but he has always backed it, and he's really been an active part of all this. So
he's a pretty good feller.
Yeah, I'll give him that.
You don't have to sleep on the couch tonight, brother.
No, I never had to.
Well, like I said, our couch is brand new and my wife won't let me sleep on it anyway. So
I'll break it in for you.
We have pillows all over it, so, you know, just help yourself. That's for sure. Well, Dave, do you have anything that you want to put out there, brother?
No, I just want to thank everybody for having us, especially you guys for having us on the show, and thank everyone for tuning in and hanging out. And it's a great show. And that's pretty much it for now.
Cool. We appreciate that. And Will, how about you, my brother? Put it out.
Happy hunting. Thanks for having us on the show. And it was a blast.
Absolutely. We're gonna have to do a re-party here before too long.
Right.
And, yeah, we'll get some new people on there with us and that type of thing. But well, we really appreciate you guys hanging out with us, and it has been an awesome show. I'm glad we got through this one, because I was really disappointed when I went back to listen to the other one. I was like, oh hell. But
this has been a really, really great fun show.
Absolutely. And you know, you get into a show that you can express yourself and get your point across and laugh all in the same time. That's awesome. You know, it's nothing uptight, and you know, you don't always have to be formal. You know, Terry Todd says he wants his show to be like sitting on the back porch drinking a beer. Well, we're just consuming a keg, as far as I'm concerned.
Yeah, I was actually drinking strawberry daiquiri, so, yeah.
Oh, hell.
Yeah, there's vinegar in there.
Yeah. So, but that's cool. Well, guys, again, thanks for being on the show. And I look forward, and we're definitely going to listen to Thursday night's show. Everybody, we invite everybody to come over to Voices Carry and listen to all the great shows. Tuesday night, we have Wiregrass Haunts. Wednesday night, have Voices Carry. Thursday night, Mysteries Explained with Will, Becky, and Dave. Tune in. It's a great show. And you guys have Jack Kenna on this coming week, right?
Yes, we do.
He is so cool. That's
awesome. Yes, he is. When he was on our show, that was just awesome. So I think you guys are going to love him. He's, he's got some stories, too. So
he shocked me because he was really, really down to earth. Like, he's just like anybody else. You know, he doesn't take any of the fame to mind.
That's what we like.
He's great.
Yeah, exactly.
Just a normal dude.
That's right. And that's exactly him.
Cool.
And Yeah, exactly. All right. Well, Miss Trista, thank you for helping me out tonight. You did an awesome job.
Aw, thanks. No problem. It was good.
Yeah, absolutely. And I'm so glad you're back. I was concerned. Well, we want to thank everybody for listening. And y'all come on back next week. And, of course, be sure to listen to Voices Carry all this coming week. All right. Well, everybody be blessed and have a great, great night.
Good night, all.
This has been a production of the Voices Carry Radio Network.